Good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to be with you here this morning on this, the fourth of our Advent Sundays. We anticipate today what's going to happen next Sunday, which is the birth of the Lord Jesus. What good news that is. So welcome everyone, and we hope that your stay here this morning will be warm and rewarding. So in today's service, as I suggested, we're looking forward to Christmas. And it's our fourth Advent spot, and we'll be singing some carols. My message is going to be about interruptions and how God uses them. Yes. And that's from Matthew chapter 1. As a call to worship, let me share a few thoughts from Psalm 84, verses 11 and 12. Is our call to worship. The Lord God is our sun and our shield. He gives us grace and glory. The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who are doing what is right. The Lord of heaven's armies, what joy for those who trust in you. Would you join me in prayer, please? Thank you, Heavenly Father, that your grace and goodness extend to all who trust in you and beyond. You are the great King, the Lord of heaven's armies. You are the sun and our shield. You shower us with every good thing as we trust you. At Christmas, when it approaches, Lord, our hearts and lives want to flourish under your goodness. And so we place our attention and our inspiration into your hands. Be with us in our daily activities and in this service. We thank you again for the opportunity to think about Emmanuel, to think about Jesus as your son, and to open our hearts. So we pray your spirit would nourish our hearts and minds as we come together with one fellowship, as one fellowship. All glory and praise be to you, gracious God, in Jesus' name. Amen. It's time to sing, and our first song is the first Noel, the angels did say. It follows the Christmas story. Let's stand, after which we're going to have the Advent spot. Let's stand with him. Thank you, Maureen and Leanne.
Thank you.
About 3 weeks ago, we started. Oh, there's some children here. Noah, would you like to come and share with us with some children? We were going to do our event, we'll do children.
Good morning, everyone. Times when angels come with special stories in the Bible, haven't we? First of all, the angel came and told Mary that she was going to have a baby. And that was an angel came and talked to Mary and told her that she was going to have a baby. Would be a little bit scary if an angel came and talked to us. We're not what we were really expecting. But then Joseph, in our story today, has an angel come in his dream. So while he's asleep and dreaming, an angel comes. Because Joseph, who was going to marry Mary, was a little bit concerned, because Mary was going to have a baby, but they hadn't lived together yet. So he thought, well, maybe I should just break it off and let her go her way, and I won't make a big fuss. But the angel said, Mary is going to have a baby, and you're going to call him Jesus. And it's because the Holy Spirit has made this baby. So don't be frightened. It's okay. And then we see angels later on, which we just sang about in our song. The angels and a whole host of angels came and talked to the shepherds and told them to come and see the baby Jesus. So angels have played a very special part when God has something that he really wants to say to us. He sometimes sends an angel to say that. Do you think you'd be a little bit scared if an angel came to your house? Or would you say, wow? I think both. I think we'd be just a little bit scared. But also, wow, what does God want me to do that he sent an angel to tell me? So today, we're going to make some angels, and we're going to talk a little bit more about angels. So when you hear the Bible reading, listen carefully and hear if you can hear about an angel in the Bible reading.
Wow, angels, shepherds, all those wonderful things in Christmas. Here, the other thing about Christmas, and the tree shows a few of it, and all around us are beautiful colours. What a sad event it would be if we didn't have colour. Some people see in black and white. most of us see in colour. And today we've got the fourth of our colours to light. 3 weeks ago we lit the purple candle, which is the candle that talks about how throughout the whole of the Old Testament there is an element of hope that God is going to fix up what happened because of Adam and Eve. And there's a plan that God has in place, and that plan brings great hope to us. And of course that plan is enacted because God so loved the world that he was going to give his only son to us. That's the red candle that we have. I know it's a little bit obscured here, but the red candle at the back here was lit 2 weeks ago to talk about God's love for us at Christmas in the sending of Jesus. And then this beautiful orange, joyful candle was lit last week. It's a sort of an orangey yellow colour, and it reminds us of the joy of Christmas. That there's a lot of smiling and happiness that's associated with the coming of Jesus. And today I'm going to invite Glennis and Fred. They're going to come and tell us about this fourth candle at the front here, a little bit about what it symbolises. Thank you, Glennis and Fred.
Symbolises peace. It reminds us of the angels who announced the good news of our Saviour's birth to the shepherds and to the entire world. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He brings peace in our troubles and will one day rule with justice and peace in the new creation. Isaiah chapter 9 verses 6 and 7 tell us, "For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with righteousness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all time. The passionate commitment of the Lord Almighty will make this happen."
Let us pray. Lord God, we light this candle to thank you for your Son and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is the peace, the Prince of Peace, who will live in discord, who live in discord and strife have found peace in the promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ. May the peace continue to guard your hearts and minds as we seek to live godly lives in these troubled times, relying on your grace. So we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name for the peace we have, because he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen.
I've got something really special for us today. Thank you, Fred, and thank you, Clement. Tony, would you like to come and join me? We've got a welcome into membership opportunity. And a member of the church is somebody who's been baptised, recognised by the church council as being within the pastoral responsibilities of this church. And that's happened for Tony last a couple of weeks ago. What happened? Something special?
Yes.
What happened a couple of weeks ago for you?
Baptized.
You were baptized, which is a wonderful thing. We define church fellowship as something that happens for those who are with each other. And Tony, we have really felt that you've been with us in this journey in the last year or so. And so we really appreciate getting to know you and having the opportunity to be with you. Did you know, friends, that there are over 50 times that the New Testament uses little commands with the word one another? We are to love one another, pray for one another, encourage one another, serve one another, even admonish one another, and so on and so forth. 50 times those little phrases with a command to one another. Here at Mudgeeraba, we have four requirements for membership. One, a personal profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Saviour and Lord, which you've done at your baptism and you can reaffirm today. Baptism as a public symbol that you are part of the church, and the completion of the membership discussion that you had with me over the last 3 or 4 months. And a commitment to abide by the Mudgeeraba Uniting Church membership expectations. Can anybody tell me what they might be? There's four of them I found, and they're wonderful. Let me share with you. Here, these are the, having received Jesus Christ as our Saviour and Lord, people that want to be part of our membership, having agreed to be baptised and so on, want to do four things, basically. To protect the unity of the church by loving each other. What do you say to that?
I will.
Share in the responsibilities of the church by giving regularly. Good. Serve the ministries of the church by volunteering and helping. Well, you're already doing that. Do you want to say yes?
Yes.
And support the worship of the church by attending regularly. Well, you're doing that too. So, would you all stand with me as I pray for Tony and give him the right hand of fellowship? Welcome into the church membership, Tony. Let's pray. Dear God, the church is your church, and we gratefully and thankfully receive Tony to be a part of that here formally today. Thank you for Tony's willingness to join us as a member at Mudgeeraba Uniting Church, for his helpful attitude and his desire to grow in you. Be with us and him as we grow together in the future. Bless us both, us all, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, Tony. Thank you for joining us. It's great to have you as part of our church. Good on you, Graham.
Good morning.
Good morning.
John Martin will be back next week for announcements, okay, but I will do them this today. But first up, let's just go over what's happened, not what's going to happen. So first of all, what's happened? Lorna's going to come up and talk about the handles.
Good morning. Wednesday, we did food hampers, Christmas food hampers here at the church. And a big, big thank you to Vicky and Pam for helping. I couldn't have done it without them. It was also the first day of half price at the op shop, so it was all very, very busy. But we did about 20 hampers. People all really appreciated them. We've got one left to be picked up. Given her 3 messages, but we'll see. But I have another family in mind if she doesn't come. So we even had one at the last minute. She had called on the day, and we were able to fix her up as well, and she came right away for hers. So that was wonderful. It was really a wonderful time. We enjoyed it. It was a beautiful day. So we will continue. And it's a time of helping not just our church and the community, but the Anglican Church. They are a big giver. They give us names and they give us some money to buy some food, and they really appreciate that we could do them up for them. And we don't mind doing that. It's wonderful. Thank you.
Then yesterday was the Frontier Barbecue. So a big thank you to Peter and John and again Vicky for helping out. With that, we made $200 for Frontier Services, who are the group within the United Church that look after those in the outback. As a follow-on from that, there's a bit of mango madness. As some of you know, Vicky gets these mangoes, And so they have four donations. So pick one or two, three, four up as you go out and give a small donation. And that money too is going to go to Frontier Services. So looking forward, the biggie is today. For the carols that happened tonight, if you're burning desire to help out and set up out there, because we're just going to be out the back, and so we've got to set that all up, that's 2 o'clock. If you're involved, you need to come 4 o'clock for the practice. Then 5 o'clock, there's pieces, and then 6:30, we kick off. So choose one of those times, or multiple times, and be here for the carols this evening. As far as our Christmas Day services, Christmas Eve is 4:30. Okay, so be here 4:30 Christmas Eve. It's going to be quite a big one, because I understand some of the Hopping family are coming. Yeah, it's been all of this time, you know, and they finally decided to come to support Jonas on Christmas Eve. So 4:30 Christmas Eve for our Christmas Eve service. And then 8 o'clock. If you come at 9 o'clock next week, you'll just catch the ending. Okay, so be here at 8 o'clock for our Christmas Day services. You will notice the Thursday Friendship cross that off that happened. Okay, so that's not happening this week. Are there any other announcements we need to put there? Okay, thank you.
Who can remember back to the 70s and the 80s? I do. That was some of my formative years in terms of learning some of the great hymns and songs of the Christian church. And our hero in those days for writing new songs was a guy named who? Graham Kendrick. And Graham Kendrick wrote some beautiful songs. And this is one of them. This is one that I've always really loved. It's called Meekness and Majesty. It refers to the character and the life of Jesus in a rather wonderful way. So would you stand as we sing this next song, one that is just with beautiful language, Meekness and Majesty. Thanks, ladies.
We just sit for the moment. I'll do the prayer of confession while we try and get the computer back online. So let's sit again. We'll do the prayer of confession. Heavenly Father, thank you for your majestic, colourful world. Its beautiful mountains, blue oceans, green forests, wonderful blue sky, and so on. We see your hand in so many of the positive human endeavours across our world. And we often reflect back to you as your creation, as your image bearers, so much that is wonderful in our world about love and joy and peace and patience and kindness. Yet, Lord, we know as we look around our world that there's much that must horrify and sadden you, all a result of human misadventure, pride and selfishness. We think of the war in Ukraine. We think of the famine in North Africa. We think of much of the tension that's happening around our world. Too often we lack love, peace, and patience. We have sown rather in selfishness and pride. Father, we confess our sins. We know that we have failed you. Lord, we also thank you again for the Lord Jesus, who in that very first Christmas came into the world to be our Saviour, to deal with our sin. And so we thank you for the forgiveness that we have in him and the renewal that takes place each day by your Holy Spirit. Lead us this coming week to live lives that are more God-honouring and express the fruit of your Spirit, not only in what we do, but what we say. Thank you again for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Friends, your sins are forgiven because of what Jesus has done for you. Are we back on track with the... Yes. Let's stand and sing Meekness and Madness.
Millions of people to leave their homes, leaving them without access to basic lifeline services. like healthcare, water, electricity and gas. Since the war began, our partner working in Ukraine and Hungary, Hungarian Interchurch Aid, has been working to help provide critical life-saving support to families that have been forced to flee their homes. This includes food, water, shelter and medical supplies for refugees who have crossed the border into Hungary and for those families who remain in Ukraine. They're also helping families to manage the trauma they've experienced and start to integrate into their new lives in new communities, in new locations, providing psychosocial support, access to community spaces, employment and vocational training activities. Together we can stand alongside Ukrainian families, providing them with practical and emotional support they need and showing them that they're not alone. In times of emergencies like the one we're seeing in Ukraine, you're helping our local partners to respond immediately, giving families safety in exile and a hope for the future when they need it most. Thank you.
We're going to sing again, Emmanuel, Jesus' name above all names. Let's stand and sing this beautiful song, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
Many people have very high expectations of Christmas. We want everything to be perfect, don't we? Who doesn't want things to be lovely and perfect at Christmas? With children playing, you know, smiling, getting along with each other, yummy food. Who doesn't want that at Christmas? You know, carols playing in the background, presents just right for you and for me, given to us by our family and friends. It's supposed to be, as that, what's that song say? The most wonderful time of the year. And we all know that that's part of our aspirations for Christmas. But often it's not that way, is it? For some people, it's the most difficult time of the year. The wonder of Christmas is interrupted. Whether that be through illness, a recent death in the family, whether it be because of financial hardship, or maybe a breakdown of a relationship, loneliness, there are many reasons why at Christmas time things are not perfect. We only have to look around our world and see what Christmas Bowl is about to know that. But we do look at the Christmas time as a season of hope and love and joy and peace, and we do so rightly. It is that. But even that very first Christmas had a number of interruptions to well-made plans. So this morning I'd like to look at that whole concept of interruptions. I have gathered two obvious ones from the passage in Matthew 1. How do we deal with interruptions in a way that nourishes our lives? Interruption number one, a surprising pregnancy for Mary. Consider the timing of Mary's pregnancy. Like Christmas today, her engagement sometime in that previous year to Joseph was supposed to be a joyful, festive time
a young girl's step into womanhood, and her security for the future was now wrapped around this young man named Joseph. And his expectations would have been for a new family, a wife to love and care for, and all sorts of expectations around marriage. In the last few weeks, I've had some pretty scary news. Most of you know a little bit about it now. My heart had gone into arrhythmia, and that is called flutter. And my pulse rate had risen from normal rate of about 75 to 80 to 105 on a regular basis. And my mother and my older brother had the same issues about my age. And if I did anything like played tennis or mowed the lawn, my heart rate would race even higher, up to 270 beats a minute. I had a number of ECGs at that stage. So I went and saw my GP, who referred me to a specialist at John Flynn, a cardiologist, from the Greek word for heart, which is cardio. So when you see a lot of those ologists, you know the Greek language is sort of linked in there somewhere. At John Flynn Hospital. And it took, of course, a couple of weeks to get to see him, but I did manage to see him. And he says, no, you're not allowed to play tennis. No, you're not allowed to mow the lawn. And you've got to be on blood thinners. And yes, we're going to do an immediate test on you to see what's going on. So last Tuesday, I went into John Flynn Hospital. And by the way, he did say this, and I took it very seriously, said, if you do, and your heart rate races up to 270, you might drop dead. That's pretty scary when the doctor says that to you. So I didn't, you'd be pleased to know. So on Tuesday, I went to John Flynn Hospital for what they called an angiogram, which was they were going to put, you can see I've got a big bruise here, they were going to put a camera up my artery down into my heart. It didn't work, and they couldn't get into the artery here, so they went through my groin. Guess where I got another big bruise? Anyway, I've gone up with this little camera up through into my heart, just to check that I didn't have any blocked arteries. Because if I had blocked arteries, I would have had to then organise the stent and other things. But I didn't, praise God. My arteries are clear enough. Now, they're not necessarily perfect, but they're good. And so, but while I was there having this angiogram, the cardiologist came to me and he said, I'd like to introduce you to my colleague here. He does oblations. And you need quickly an oblation. He's had a cancellation today. We can put you in for an oblation after you have your angiogram. Would you want that to happen? Now let me tell you what was going on for me on that Tuesday. I had planned to do the devotions for the Tuesday women's group, the craft group that met here on Tuesday morning. I was at John Flynn Hospital at 6:30 to have that angiogram done by about 8 o'clock so I could come home, come to the ladies' craft group, do the devotion, stay on for the church council meeting. So what do you say to a doctor that says, oh, we've got a spot for you right now? So I said, yes, please. I said, I better tell my wife, however, because by that stage I had a gown on and no clothes, and no phone, and nothing. I'm just lying there waiting for the angiogram. And I said, well, I better tell my wife what's happening. And so I rang her and I told her I'm going to have, as well as this angiogram, I'm going to have an oblation and I'll have to ring you after it happens to tell you when you can come and get me. Because to have that, you go under a general or a major and it's, yeah. So anyway, So God had other plans for me other than going to do the ladies' craft group in the church council. So here I was, there, and the other specialist that was going to do the ablation says to me, you might have to stay overnight. And so that rang alarm bells as well, because on Wednesdays, you know that I am the chaplain at the local aged care facility, where I had prepared months in advance to do a service there called the Service of Remembrance of Christmas. Over 20 residents had passed away at Cedarbrook during the year, and I was doing a service on Wednesday afternoon for all the families of people who had lost loved ones during Christmas. And so here they say to me, you might be in hospital tomorrow. And I said to them, well, I can't do it. I've got a ring. And the cardiologist said to me, he said, leave it with me. You'll be out tomorrow morning at the very latest. And I thought, what do you say? And I said, thank you. That's relieved me a lot. Anyway, they did it. I woke up a couple of hours later and I'm in this bed in the ward, and just waiting to go, and I don't know what's happening, and I don't know how long I've been asleep, or there's no clock, I haven't got my watch, I don't know what time it is. Anyway, a nurse finally comes in and says, oh, you're awake. And so we had this lovely little chat, and I said, I need to tell my wife. And she said, oh, okay, I'll find out where your clothes and your phone are. They lost them. So my bag of clothes, which I'd taken off at a totally different ward and a downstairs and everything like that. So here I am in this bed with this, just a gown on, thinking, I want to go home. And I want to, you know, want to know what's happening, and I want to know all sorts of things. And the cardiologist had said to the nurses, yes, when John wakes up, he can go home. And so I'm thinking, oh, good. Anyway, I was lying there and I'm dozing a bit because, you know, that's what happens when you're... And then I sort of come out and I think, I haven't told Dean what's happened. It's been, and the nurse told me what the time is. Oh, no. And so because I can't get my clothes and can't get my phone, I said to the nurse, I said, can I ring my wife and tell her what's happening? She'll be deeply concerned. And so they gave me a ward phone. And Lynn says, I got this call from the John Flynn Hospital. He said, I nearly died. It wasn't from your phone. He said, I was so pleased to hear your voice. When it was your voice and not the voice of someone from John Flynn Hospital. Anyway, just to let you know, my heart is much better. Thank you, and your prayers appreciate. I now have a heart rate back to normal in my about 80, and I've got no issues with excessive high blood pressure or anything. And so the ablation has worked. By the way, what that is they send this little burning thing, this little cable up into your heart, into my right ventricle, and they give you a little zap, and it changes the electrical impulses of your heart. And so instead of having a flutter, and a heart rate of well over 100, it goes back to what it should. So praise God, and I'm seeing the specialist again on Wednesday to make sure that's all happened well. So sorry to take a big detour about what's happened for me, but let's go back to young Mary. Young Mary was hoping and praying for a blessed marriage within the coming year. But it was during her engagement that the angel told her that she was about to become pregnant. She was going to miraculously conceive a child even though she was still a virgin. Now, let me ask you this question. If you were Mary, was that good news or bad news? Well, yes and no. Their engagement plans were in danger of being very severely interrupted, I would say, by that news. And her future security was looking very confused. How would she explain a pregnancy to, firstly, to her own family, And then to her engaged husband-to-be, Joseph. Would he believe her? Would he be willing to take on the responsibility that that meant? Raising a child that wasn't his own? This pregnancy was not part of her original plans, was it? It was an interruption that was on the way to, that could possibly derail her life. And yet we know that she joyfully accepted it with humility. She said, I want to be the Lord's servant. And that's always a very good thing to be. To be the mother of God's son, well, that was going to be good news for her. What a privilege. So what can we learn quickly from Mary and about interruptions? Well, we've got to learn that we have to be a bit humble, don't we? Although her life plans were in jeopardy and falling apart, she listened and she agreed to give her consent to that interruption. Humility is a great virtue, and when we get knocked off track, it's hard to be humble. So let's take a moment to humbly reflect on this question, where is God in this? And as that cardiologist said to me, you can have an oblation now, I said to myself, wow, is this what God wants for me? And you've got to process that. It doesn't happen immediately. So, and secondly, you've got to obey God's call. Mary heard what God wanted for her and she said yes. Now, if we get interrupted, we need to take a moment to say, where is God in this? What does he want us to be doing and saying? And how does he want us to act? I've got a little video for you called Mary, Did You Know? And it's a lovely song that you will know. Thanks. Let's listen to it.
Your baby boy is born where angels
His engagement plans. Did you know that Joseph, what Joseph was thinking? Well, it's recorded for us quite there in Matthew. Joseph responded to Mary telling him that she was pregnant. It says that he didn't really believe her. How could he? Impossible, Joseph thought. Everyone knows how a girl gets pregnant, don't we? We all know that. It's not by a word from an angel saying that the Holy Spirit was going to come. Who's ever heard of that? So, interestingly, in verse 20, it says that Joseph was considering this. The word that Matthew uses for considering has a basic meaning of being upset or angry. Joseph heard that Mary was pregnant. And while he was waging war within himself about that, he got quite upset. Wouldn't you, if you found out that your fiancée, who you knew hadn't been with you, was now pregnant? Divorce is what he decided. Yet because he was a just and kind man, he did not want to publicly embarrass or humiliate Mary. His anger turns to mercy. He would divorce her privately, just between the two families. This was Joseph's human response to a powerful interruption. Anger initially, and then a kindness in a private divorce. But what a mistake a divorce would have been. Thankfully, God rescued Joseph from his would-be error. I can imagine Joseph, having learned about Mary's pregnancy, wasn't sleeping all that well. He would have been tossing and turning. He would have been quite upset by it all. And then when he finally goes to sleep, he finds out in a dream from an angel that he's doing the wrong thing. Joseph, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. What she says is true. You're going to have a son. You're going to marry her and so on. And Joseph woke up, and he did change his mind. He didn't divorce Mary, he married her instead. He'd gotten God's perspective on his interruption. Now, Ben Witherington says this about Joseph. Joseph was willing to give up what was often perceived to be a Jewish father's greatest privilege, that is, siring his firstborn son. He did it in order to obey God's will. Isn't that a lovely thought? Good on you, Joseph. Kenneth Bailey, another writer from the Middle East who lived all his life in the Middle East, writes this about Joseph. Joseph is revealed here as a person of remarkable stature. He possesses the boldness, daring, and courage and strength of character to stand up against his entire community and take a pregnant Mary as his wife. He did so in spite of forces that no doubt wanted her publicly disgraced. His vision of justice stayed his hand. In short, he was able to repossess his anger into grace. When you encounter an interruption or a curveball, as Joseph did, whatever that might be, please don't react just on your feelings. Consider what's going on. Seek God's advice. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and don't rely on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will guide you on the right paths." There are three words from this story I think that really help us as we encounter interruptions in our lives. Firstly is prayer. So the first thing to do when we encounter interruptions is to give the situation over into God's hands. He is sovereign, He is still in control. And even though, what's that song say? The thrill of hope, because a weary world is able to rejoice. We're going to sing that song tonight, I think, and a whole lot of other Christmas carols. You must come tonight, it should be fantastic. So that's what prayer does. Prayer gives us perspective. James 1, 5 and 6, is it any of you lack wisdom? Ask our generous God, and He will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking, but when you ask Him, be sure that your faith is in Him alone. So pray, and in a time, be humble in prayer, because ask yourself, what's this interruption part of His plans for me? And talk to Him about it. Then take number two, perspective. Put the interruption into its proper perspective. And so in my circumstances, I said to the cardiologist, this is what's going to happen for me. And I need it to happen. And he said, well, I'll make it happen for you. Now, of course, another interruption could have happened. I could have had a heart attack on the table. But praise God, He was there with me in that journey. And so you have to be patient as well. Keep in mind that God is still in control of our lives, that with the psalmist we should say, our God reigns, and we should believe it with all of our hearts, and live with patience in the midst of interruptions. Some interruptions can be positive and redirect our lives. I think for Mary and Joseph, the interruptions were great. For me, it was a great interruption too. Because I was going to have a cloud over me at Christmas if I hadn't had that oblation. And so I was praising God that you can imagine me thanking Him. Some interruptions can be great opportunities. When an interruption comes, maybe we should look in a way that says, what is God doing in all of this? And have you considered what God is doing? And interesting. When I had that conversation, I was with that cardiologist about what I had to do the next day. It only occurred to me later that that had been a fantastic opportunity to say something about the Christian gospel to this cardiologist and to sow a little seed in him that might have been something that he contemplates and thinks about. Hey, this guy is so committed to being a chaplain that he wants to be with these people and these families tomorrow to share with them in a service of remembrance for their loved ones. And I want to be part of that for him. So I'm sure that there was a little seed sown, well, I don't know, I pray that it had been, in the cardiologist that heard my, and there were two, the three nurses standing there, and they're all going, yes, you know, so it wasn't just him. About three or four people heard my story that I wanted to be at the church council and stuff, and that had gone away by that stage, but that I wanted to be at Cedarwood. So whenever interruptions happen, whether it's now or when you're going towards Christmas, there's always one thing to do. Stop and thank God for Jesus. Stop and thank God for Jesus. If your life's in a mess, that doesn't mean that God is not with you in that journey. And thank Him for the hope, the love, the joy and the peace that only Jesus can bring into our lives. He is our Saviour. And I thank God He was with me on that operating table, as many of you have just recently. And thank Him also for your family and your church. It's good to have that. And as we praise and thank God, even in the midst of difficult circumstances, something of that wonderful peace that only Jesus can bring. As Paul said to the Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. Let your cares be known to Him in all your ways, and so on and so forth. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds. So God bless you this Christmas, and hopefully I'll see you this afternoon or next Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. Christmas Day is my last service with you. There will be a few tears for me in that, but let's make it a God-blessed time. Let's pray. We're going to take a moment to pray now. Appreciate your prayers as a church considering my name for next year today. And I appreciate your prayers about that. And also, we're praying for the people like myself and John over there and Lorraine and others that have been part of having illnesses and so on. So we pray for that. And Vicky, you've got a name for us?
Yes, Tony Roberts has injured his back.
The chaplain that we support, Tony Roberts, has injured his back. So we pray for that as well. So let's take a few moments to pray, not only for our world, but for each other. Precious Father, we name those names that we've just mentioned and the circumstances around them, and we lift them to your throne of grace, asking that you would move powerfully in all of the peoples and circumstances. We do pray for Ukraine, we pray for the countries in the north of Africa that experience poverty, we pray for many countries around the world that this Christmas, instead of the joy being there, it's difficult circumstances. And so we commit ourselves and our ways and the Christmas bowl appeal and so on into your gracious hands. And we thank you for the privilege of knowing you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to finish with a Christmas calypso carol. We've got a bit longer than I hoped today. I told you a 10-minute story about myself. I apologise for that. But let's stand and sing this beautiful calypso carol called The Virgin Mary Had a Baby Boy. You know that one?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we've got to sing it with a West Indian beat. So, a calypso carol. Sing it brightly, and let's stand and do that before the benediction.
Come from the glorious kingdom.
wonderful experience. Please come along to any of those services, and particularly this afternoon should be great. Let me share again what the angel declared. I bring you good news that will be great joy for all people. The Saviour, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem. And the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the angel, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to whom his favour rests. God bless you this week. Have a good one, and catch you, most of you, or hopefully some of you this afternoon. And morning tea's on now, so please join us. Shake Tony's hand as a new member.